I was interested to see something hit my inbox, which is the moment that Elon Musk threatened to decommission Dragon, which was a response to the president of the United States threatening to cancel government contracts of some of Elon Musk's companies. You made the argument that now is the time to talk and realize that we need many more options for space beyond SpaceX, which dominates commercial payload from Earth to orbit. Do you believe that you are one such option?
Well, of course we are. In the government space, we are the primary competitor to SpaceX. And also, we are the major supplier to Amazon's Kuiper constellation, which will offer competition in the LEO-based internet market.
Did you hear from Pentagon officials amid the blow-up, Tory, to get specific?
We're in constant conversations with our customers in the Pentagon. And, I don't know any more than you guys do about how all of that will turn out. I'm sure those gentlemen will sort it out between them. But it does point out, as you alluded to, Ed, how important it is, given a growing commercial sector and the challenges we face in space from China, that we have a broad industrial base with multiple companies in a competitive environment to support that ever-growing need.
That ever-growing need, you mentioned Kuiper, for example. Give us an update of just how many launches you think you're going to be doing this year, which vehicles you're going to be using, Tory.
Well, this year we'll be flying both our Heritage Atlas vehicle, which we have flown actually twice, once as a demo, but once now with 27 Kuipers on orbit, and our Vulcan, our brand new vehicle. The next launch will be another Atlas, and then we're going to pivot back to the United States government to do a couple of national security space launches with Vulcan. And then after that, we'll come right back to Amazon with another Vulcan. That's important because Vulcan is almost two Atlases. It's 45 spacecraft versus 27. And then as fast as we can have satellites and availability on the range, we'll fly several more times before the end of the year.
I think that's the question I get for you most, Tory. There is actually a lot of interest in Vulcan. Specifically, when will Vulcan fly again? And what are the kind of challenges right now for the arc of the rest of the year against the goals you set yourself for Vulcan?
Yeah, well, Vulcan has just finished its development. We've flown two missions. We are now certified for national security. We are also prepared for the commercial launches. The customers have not yet announced their launch dates, and we always let them do that first. But I can tell you that it'll be very soon. It'll be this summer when we fly Vulcan again, and we'll be flying it into the fall and into the winter as well.
Tory, you just gave Caroline the answer, several. Could I hold you to a number, please? Be that high single digits, 5, 10? Get specific for me, please.
It'll be single digits, yeah. I can't give you a specific number because we have to request launch dates on the range, which has now become kind of a crowded place because of all this wonderful commercial activity. And it's too early to know when all of those slots will be available. But I can tell you it'll be less than probably 10 more missions this year, but high single digits.
Tory, you've been perhaps faced with some criticism coming from the Air Force earlier in the year, the assessment that perhaps there was subpar performance meeting some of the key goals. And I'm interested in that you've really been focused in this. You've been focused on getting the engineering talent and the force that you need there to make up for it, the management focus as well, Tory. What is the limiting factor when it comes to your engineering capacity? What is it that means that you can't fire on all cylinders, pun the pun?
This is really a typical development journey where we're doing an all-new heavy-class launch vehicle. We had hoped to be done with it before the end of last year. It took us just a little bit longer. We had a delay in our upper stage. We had a structural failure way back early last year that we had to recover from. And then when we flew our second certification flight, we lost the nozzle off of one of our solid rocket motors that are added on, strapped on. You know, interestingly enough, the mission itself was perfect. It was the most accurate insertion we've ever done. But nonetheless, those two things delayed us finishing up development, which we've now come through and are on the other side. I'll tell you that I have developed some 36 systems over the, you know, the last 4 decades. This actually is one of the cleanest ones I've ever been through or have seen, but it just took a little bit longer to get to where we are today.
Tori, I want to go back to the origin of our discussion, which was Elon Musk's threat to decommission Dragon. Let's just state the basic fact that SpaceX absolutely dominates human and non-human payload to orbit. Mm-hmm. How bad would that be? I mean, we're basically talking about taking away an apparatus that America depends on to get to space right now.
It would, for a period of time, a certain number of months, put us back in a position of being dependent upon the Russians to go to and from the space station. But it's not a permanent impact to the program, should that have happened, because there is another program, the Boeing Starliner, also known as CST-100, that has had a demo flight, and they actually carried crew to the space station once already. It had some problems with some thrusters and some valving. Those are being sorted out. And NASA has said they expect it to begin flying again in early 2026. So we would have a gap where we're right. dependent on the Russians until that's available. After that vehicle, there's a company called Sierra Space that will take cargo to and from with their Dream Chaser vehicle. It's a very cool vehicle, lifting body, kind of looks like a small futuristic space shuttle. That will also transition to human transport as well, but a little bit later.
Tori, last year the reports were that ULA was subject to acquisition, right? That Blue Origin might be a potential bidder. What's the latest on the future of this group, this JV, and the relationship with Blue, who are supposed to also be providing you with engines?
Well, like any M&A kind of question, I'm never allowed to speculate, talk, or answer anything about that. I can tell you that ULA is a very sound company. It, as I said, it's the primary competitor to SpaceX here in the United States. There's only currently 2 domestic launch providers in this class, soon to be a third with Blue Origin. So it's a great company, and I wish I owned it. But beyond that, I really can't talk about anything that would be an M&A.